Hi, so my name is Forrest Li, and I will be talking today about evaluating CUDA applications under EDF scheduling for use in autonomous vehicles. I'll get to the acronyms in just a moment. But first, I want to present. Then I want to go to the next slide. So the motivation behind this has been largely also talked about by Vance, but the idea is we want cars to see their environment. We want cars to be able to process that about their environment. So what we have here is all those different things that cars can detect. They can detect traffic signs. They can do a surround view on your blind spot. They can do adaptive cruise control, all this sort of stuff. And this all falls under autonomous vehicles as well as advanced driver assist systems. So in particular, we're really focused on image data because right now stuff like LiDAR and all these other fancy detection technologies are kind of expensive. So the idea is we want to be able to process all these images that we get from cameras in real time because, one, we don't want to miss frames, and two, if we miss frames, we're going to flatten a pedestrian. No, we don't want that. So we use CUDA image processing. CUDA is a platform developed by Nvidia. It leverages the parallel processing of graphics processing units to do other work other than rendering rendering a cat video or something. So CUDA can be used for fast image analysis. And as we can see in this image here, we have box outlines of things that that an image task has detected. So you've got cars there, you see a pedestrian on the right side, and then you see there's a red square around the signpost, so we can identify things. And we need to identify things in real time with periodicity because, well, we're getting frames in some sort of frame rate, like 30 frames per second, and so we need to be able to process all this. And on this platform, we did work on the Nvidia Jetson TK1, which is low cost. It is very powerful for its size, at least. And it's up to 326 gigaflops on the GPU, which is definitely sufficient for certain image tasks. Not everything, but that's a separate issue. And in particular, it runs Linux. Why does this matter? Because we want to run this in real time, and what we want to use is something called earliest deadline first scheduling. So this is a real-time scheduler. A scheduler is simply it's an operation done by the kernel. It tells tasks in a system when they should run and how long they should run. So for EDF scheduling, we characterize tasks using three parameters: their execution time, their deadline, and period. For the purposes of what I was doing, deadline and period are effectively equivalent. So the basic idea is EDF guarantees tasks will always finish, or will always meet their deadlines, so long as some metric of the utilization, the sum of their metrics of the utilizations is less than one, or in this case, it's one, but in reality, if you have M CPUs, it's going to be less than the number of CPUs that you have. And if you go over that value, you're going to cause overruns and not all tasks can meet the deadline. So Linux supports EDF, and it so happens that the Nvidia Jetson TK1 doesn't necessarily support it directly, so a lot of work went into getting the TK1 to even support EDF in the first place. So as an example, here is a graph indicating how EDF tasks run, whether they stay within their deadline or whether they extend over. So x-axis is going to be your time. Y-axis has absolutely no meaning. And the color really is what you want to focus on. Color means process is executing. No color means, well, it's not doing anything. So this was all done using matrix multiplication. And so on the top one, you see that that matrix multiplication stayed within its deadline. The worst case execution time of the matrix multiplication operation I was doing was around 11 milliseconds. And I gave it a runtime of 100 milliseconds. So its allotment is 100 milliseconds. So that went fine. It's nice and periodic. It runs just well. Now, the second one exceeds its deadline. One iteration runs for about 150 milliseconds, while I allotted it 100 milliseconds. And as you can see, it runs, so this is actually a 100 millisecond time slot. So each of these longer bars are 100 millisecond time slots. And it runs, and then what happens here is EDF says, no, I'm not going to let you run anymore. I'm going to throttle you, and I'm not going to let you run until your next period. So it stalls there, and then it picks up again when it's allowed to run on the next period, and then it finishes its task. Now imagine if this was processing image data. You process a frame, you keep going, you're told by the scheduler, stop, and then you start up again on the next frame. By this point, your next image frame should have come over, but you're still parsing the first image frame. Not good, because then you might get a backlog of images, and then you're going to run over pedestrian. Not good. So EDF and CUDA, can they work together? First answer, no, not really. But actually, you can sort of finagle it to get it to work. So by default, CUDA is inherently a hybrid programming model. There's a CPU and a GPU. It so happens that, well, GPU tasks that are running on GPU are non-preemptible. You can't just say, oh, I want that task to stop. I want to swap it in a new task. It's not like your regular multitasking operating systems. Only one task is allowed to run until it finishes, or you kill the device, one of the two. So that's not necessarily what our concern is with right now, as long as the tasks stay within their deadlines. The other problem is, well, getting EDF and CUDA to run nicely together doesn't really work because details. So CUDA is a closed source platform. It's very opaque, and getting anything out of it is, or at least getting anything implementation-wise out of it, is probably like trying to walk into a wall. So not fun. So solution for this is we need to figure out what in the world we're doing. We need to take a look at, we need to experiment, run programs through EDF and CUDA and see what in the world happens. So short answer, EDF and CUDA will not work if you drop the CUDA application into an EDF system. In fact, you'll get a really big fat error, and you'll be like, I don't know what I'm doing. So in order to actually get EDF and CUDA running, we need to quickly go dive into CUDA internals. So when you set up a CUDA application, you initialize the device. And when you initialize the device, you create a callback thread. So the CUDA application doesn't talk directly to the GPU and get signals back. There's actually a CUDA callback thread that will handle all the signal handling for you. And the CUDA app thread simply sits there and says, OK, I'm going to wait a little bit. And then once I get a signal from the callback thread, I'm good to go. I got my results, and I can go forward. So that worker thread is actually the reason why you can't, by default, run CUDA applications under EDF, because it just doesn't like it. So one solution is we schedule it independently of the application thread. We say the app thread is going to run under EDF, but we don't want the callback thread to run under EDF. Let's run it under another real-time class. Let's say first in, first out, or for short, FIFO. So let's see what happens there. So this is CUDA matrix multiplication. And what this graph is showing you is what happens when you exceed your allotted runtime. So without EDF, this operation takes around 40 milliseconds. When you run under EDF, it takes about 90 milliseconds. And so you see right here, that's 90 milliseconds. You can see the nice periodicity of it. So these chunks. But for some reason, 90 milliseconds decides to cover one period and then part of another one. So that's not very good. And we see that, well, OK, clearly this is not what we want. So what happens if we run it, if we have a task that has a runtime less than the allotted runtime that I gave it? it's not much better. So we see it's still 40 milliseconds. I bumped up the allotted runtime to 100 milliseconds, and we get 303 milliseconds. So where in the world did we go wrong? It turns out that the callback thread actually runs on the same CPU as the application thread. And this is actually very undesirable. So earliest deadline first on Linux actually has the highest user space priority of any other task inside the system, which means that it's non-preemptible until the schedule says, okay, you are done. So what happens is the callback thread is spawned and it says, okay, I'm gonna try to run, but wait, nope. The application thread has not finished up its allotment. So what happens is you run a GPU task, it sends its stuff to the GPU, and then it spin waits for a response from the callback thread. Well, there's a problem. Callback thread's not running because it can't run. So once the allotted time finishes and there's that little period before it finishes the entire period, you say, okay, the callback thread can now run, but you signal and there's really nothing that's waiting for the signal because there's nothing running. And once everything starts up again, on the second period, the app thread finally starts up and then gets the signal. That's late. We don't want that. So that's exactly why that happened, because you can see two different segments. It ran. This is right here, the callback thread is like, okay, I can now send the signal. It ran. Or actually, sorry, that's an interrupt. Ignore that. I ran, callback gives me the signal. That little part right there is saying, oh, okay, I got the results. I can now pull it in. But by then, you probably got like 50,000 more, not 50,000, but you probably got at least one or two more frames from your camera. Not good. You're going to hit that pedestrian. So different ways you can resolve this. There, you can try to put the change CPU affinity. You can try saying, okay, the app thread runs on one CPU, the callback thread runs another CPU. So they should be able to shouldn't mess with each other. One shouldn't step on the other's feet, and it should work just fine. Sort of. This is just one thing we can do. I did initial testing on it, and it's still not reliable. It'll actually start throwing random errors. So not entirely sure what's happening there, but that is one route to fix some of the issues. The other one is to use task splitting. So instead of saying, I'm going to run and then I'm going to send off a task to the GPU, and then I'm going to wait for a result back, and then process it and call that a single period, how about we just split it up into two? So we use something called task splitting, where we say, I'm going to fire off the operation, and then on my next period, I'm going to read the input and make any signals that I need to do. And that just means, oh, I'm going to cut my... So if I get a frame of every 1/30th of a second, then I'm just going to cut that in half. I'm going to say the period is 1/60th, and I'm going to have two distinct different periods. So that's another way to do it, but right now both of those ways are still haven't been tested, only because CUDA and EDF are probably the most annoying things ever to work with. So for future work, and as a general summary, I established a proof of concept implementation of CUDA and EDF, which I have not seen anywhere else. I've spent some time looking, and as far as I'm concerned, no one has ever tried running CUDA application under EDF. Also, EDF is kind of not really new. 2010. This is specifically talking about in Linux. So in general, a lot of work has just been done to get everything working. One, getting an actual running kernel with EDF on the TK1 was pain. Also, getting CUDA to even remotely work with EDF was another pain. But in the future, what would be useful is to characterize deadline misses with CUDA applications, specifically considering how the GPU is a completely separate beast from the CPU, and so we can't actually stop what we're doing on the GPU without being a detriment to the entire system. And we still need to actually run image processing tasks on it and throw more tasks into it because, well, you're not just going to do matrix multiplication and only matrix multiplication in order to avoid pedestrians and drive down a road. You have a bunch of other stuff to do. You've got a bunch of other sensors. You've got more than one camera looking forward, backward, left, right, all sorts of directions. So that's what still needs to be done. So future, your car is most definitely going to have some eyes of some sort. Probably not the ones in the windshield, but the point is made. Thank you. So that's CUDA specific, and I'm not entirely sure how the callback thread actually interfaces with the GPU, most likely interrupts.
So is that callback thread running as part of the kernel driver, or is it just
user space? Yeah.
And there are
ask Nvidia. Yeah, and you can also, if you miss deadlines only sporadically and not all the time, you can just say, I'm just going to drop that frame, because usually it's kind of safe to do it, but unless if you know that something really bad is going to happen, dropping a frame is pretty bad, but it just varies. Kind of a mix of both. So you can specify different ways to wait for a signal. You can either spin lock, so that's just burning CPU cycles. You can specify yield, which means I'm going to yield to the scheduler, and once I get rescheduled, hopefully the event will have occurred, or I could do a blocking synchronization, which is just blocks. And so that's actually something you can specify in the application. So on this specific board, the Jetson TK1, it actually doesn't support OpenCL. Or it just, so CUDA is pretty much the only thing that can run on it.
And this board is just attractive for
the price point, it's low power consumption, and CUDA usage.